Hello students, welcome to today's English class. Today I'll be explaining you the first chapter of your supplementary textbook snapshots, and the chapter is entitled The Summer of the Beautiful White Horse by William Saroyan. And this chapter makes an interesting reading. This chapter is about two Armenian boys. Armenian means they belonging to that particular tribe where all Armenian, like we are Indians, they were Armenians. They belong to a particular tribe mentioned, the Garoclanian tribe, and the hallmarks of their tribe are trust and honesty. Hallmarks means the qualities by which that particular tribe is known for. Fine, their entire family, the entire community was well known in the world for being trustworthy and honest. And dear students, these two boys were adolescents. They were quite young in age, and life threw a temptation in front of them, which put them into a situation, into a catch-22 situation. On one hand, they had an opportunity to give shape to all their childish fantasies, and on one hand, there was the hallmarks of their family. They had to choose one of these, either to fulfill their childish desires or to stick by trust and honesty. So let's explore further. What did they do? Whether they had the courage enough to resist the temptation offered to them, or they were strong enough to adhere to the hallmarks of their family, trust and honesty. So it makes an interesting reading. So without coming between into the beauties the chapter has and you, I would just start the explanation. One day back there in the good old days when I was 9, narrator is one of the two boys I have just let you know of. One day back there in old good days when I was 9, when narrator was 9 and the world was full of every imaginable kind of magnificence for a 9-year-old boy, the world is a kind of imagination. It's a kind of fairy world which is filled with magnificence. They have not yet seen the realities of life, so they find world to be a magnificent place, and life was still a delightful and mysterious dream. Life remains extremely delightful and a dream filled with mysteries because they have yet to explore the bounties of the world, explore the situations which a human being has to confront during his life. So life was a kind of mysterious dream for that 9-year-old narrator. On that particular day, my cousin Murad, who was considered crazy by everybody who knew him except me, came to my house at 4 in the morning. So the narrator was sleeping. On that particular morning, his cousin Murad, everybody considered Murad to be a crazy boy, but that narrator did not consider. So that cousin Murad came to his house at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he woke him up by tapping on the window of my room. He just knocked at the window of his room and woke him up. Aram, he said, Aram was the name of the narrator. Aram is the name of the narrator. So he asked Aram to get up. I jumped out of bed and looked out of the window at 4 o'clock. If there is a tap on the window of your room, you are surprisingly alert, and you have to jump. You just out of surprise, you jump out of bed and look out of the window to find out who had knocked at the door. The same Aram did. I couldn't believe what I saw. Aram couldn't believe the spectacle he saw when he looked at the window. It wasn't morning yet, but it was summer with daybreak not many minutes around the corner of the world. It was not a complete morning yet. It was the month of the summer, so daybreak was about to occur at 4. You know, the day is about to rise and dawn in, and so it was light enough for me to know I wasn't dreaming. So it was not as dark as would make somebody believe that he was dreaming. So he could find that it was a reality. Whatever he saw, the spectacle he saw was unbelievable. It was incredible. My cousin Murad, what was the spectacle that he see? What was the scene that he see? My cousin Murad was sitting on a beautiful white horse. he saw his cousin Murad was sitting on a beautiful white horse. Now, how can somebody's cousin sitting on a beautiful white horse be an incredible spectacle? We'll come to know. I stuck my head out of the window and rubbed my eyes in disbelief. I wanted to make it doubly sure whether whatever I was watching was true or not. So I rubbed my eyes. Yes, he said in Armenian. My cousin Murad said, using the language Armenian which they spoke, which was their mother tongue. It's a horse. Don't look at me in disbelief. You are watching a horse. You are watching your cousin sitting on a horse. You are not dreaming. Aram, make it quick if you want to ride. I'm going to enjoy a morning ride. If you want to accompany me, make it quick, get ready and come. So he offered, Murad offered Aram to join him the horse ride early in the morning at 4 o'clock, and this spectacle was something that Aram couldn't believe. Now let's see whether Aram would straight away join the morning ride or he would just first make some queries. I knew my cousin Murad enjoyed being alive more than anything else who had ever fallen into the world by mistake. But this was more than even I could believe. He just pondered over the situation. Aram just analyzed the situation, and Aram knew that his cousin Murad was a happy-go-lucky person. He enjoyed being alive more than anyone else who had fallen into this world by mistake. So here the poet, narrator is taking a dig at those people who come to this world and they don't enjoy. So he believes that such people come to this world by mistake. But Murad was not like that. He was a vivacious personality. He was a happy-go-lucky person. He was cheerful. He wanted to make the most of every moment of his life. This fact was known by Aram. But the thing that he witnessed that particular morning, the sight that he happened to saw that particular morning, that particular spectacle was unbelievable. It was incredible. In what was the reason of its incredibility? In the first place, my earliest memories had been memories of horses. So he is making it clear to the readers that he was fond of horses. He had dreamt of horses, and my first longings, my first desires had been desires to ride. So Aram desperately wanted to enjoy a horse ride, and there was an opportunity in front of him. He could just straight away get up, get ready and enjoy that. But before that, he calculated the situation. He analyzed the situation. There was a temptation in front of him to just fulfill his long cherished desire. But he just made certain calculations and certain thoughts came into his mind. This was the wonderful part. The situation was there. He wanted to ride horses desperately, and there was a horse available. So this was the situation. And that he had a great desire to ride horses. This was the wonderful part of the situation, that there was a horse and he wanted to ride. In the second place, the other thing that was putting him in dilemma, the reality of the situation was putting him in fix. What was that? We were poor. They were poor. This was the part that wouldn't permit me to believe that what I saw. So he was not able to believe the spectacle he witnessed because of the fact that they were extremely poor, and affording a horse was a luxury those days. We were poor. We had no money. Our whole tribe was poverty stricken. Each and every member of their tribe was poor. Every branch of Gerglenian family was living in the most amazing and comical poverty in the world. So any person of Gerglenian family lived in any part of the world, they were poor. And this fact that every person belonging to a particular community, irrespective of the part of the world he lives in, is poor, makes this poverty amazing and comical, surprising and comical. How can every member of a particular tribe be poor? And so this makes it a little bit comical and amazing. Nobody could understand where we ever got money enough to keep us with food in our bellies. The way they had been making both ends meet, the way they were surviving into the world, it was quite surprising. It was quite understandable that how could such poor people arrange money every day to buy food to fill their bellies with. Not even the old man of the family, even the old man of the family were not known to this. They were in disbelief that how such a tribe was surviving against the direst of the poverty. Most important of all, though we were famous for our honesty, still, see, it's quite difficult when you are struggling hard, when you are extremely poor, and staying poor and honest is a hard combination. But they had maintained this combination. You know, when you don't have two square meals of the day, you are inclined to do wrong things. You are inclined to steal food. But the members of the Garoglinian family had maintained their honesty despite many uncertainties about their livelihood, about their sustenance. We had been famous for our honesty for something like 11 centuries. So it was a long heritage of honesty they had been carrying along with. Even when we had been the wealthiest family in what we like to think was the world, many centuries back, Garoglinian family used to be the wealthiest family in the world. But still, they even that moment, they were honest. And hard times they went by didn't make them compromise with their honesty. When they were struggling for their sustenance, when they were struggling for their livelihood, they had maintained their honesty. We were proud first, honest next. So the sense of pride coming out of being honest was dominating their lives. And after that, we believed in right and wrong. Yeah, those people believe in right and wrong. And my dear students, if you believe in right and wrong, if you evaluate your actions on the parameter of the actions being right or wrong, you are always going to be right. So whenever your conscience, your inner voice checks you before doing an action, it tells you that it's wrong, it is right. Do introspect over the action you are going to do and then choose the right from the wrong. None of us would take advantage of anybody in the world. It was quite difficult for any member of the family of Garoglinian to take advantage of anybody in the world, let alone steal. This let alone steal is a beautiful expression of language. I would like all of you to imbibe let alone steal means what to speak of stealing. They couldn't even take the advantage of anybody in the world. Let alone means what to speak of. Fine, suppose let me use this sentence in a beautiful sense so that it is quite understandable to you. You want to say that some of the students in your class cannot even speak Hindi fluently, and asking them to speak in English is a far cry. So you can say, what to speak of English? I should say that not to speak of. Fine, not to speak of English. Some students of our class cannot even speak Hindi fluently. I would like to translate this and use mother tongue. English ki to baat hi kya kare? Kuch bachche to Hindi bhi nahi bol sakte hain. Not to speak of English, some students of our class cannot even speak Hindi fluently. Let alone steal is one of such structures that can be used to express such sentences. Let me convert the sentence I have spoken using let alone steal. Some of the students of our class cannot speak even Hindi fluently, let alone English. Some of the students of our class cannot even speak Hindi fluently, let alone English. Fine. Or you can say, I cannot buy basic essentials of the day, let alone luxurious items. Fine. So I would like you to make some sentences on this structure in your fair notebooks. Moving on, consequently, even though I could see the horse, consequently means as a result, even though he could see the horse, horse was magnificent, even though I could smell it, he was so fond of horses that he could smell it. So lovely, Even though I could hear it breathing, he could hear the breath of the horse. It was so exciting. I couldn't believe the horse had anything to do with my cousin Murad or with me. He knew that how could a member of Garuglenian family afford to have a horse or any of the other members of the family asleep or awake. It was a lie. It was something that was unbelievable, whether you are asleep or awake. Because I knew my cousin Murad couldn't have bought the horse, it was clear. And if he couldn't have bought the horse, he must have stolen it. This was also clear. And I refused to believe he had stolen it. But believing that he had stolen it was also quite unbelievable. How could a member of Garuglenian family be a thief? Honesty ran in their blood. So this was quite a difficult situation to analyze. This was a catch-22 situation, in English we say. This was quite an enigmatic situation, a kind of puzzle it was. Now, the situation before Aram, the narrator of the story, was that he was extremely fond of horses. He had always dreamt of enjoying a horse ride. It was his long cherished dream. Now there was an opportunity before him to just fulfill his dream. But his conscience, his inner voice was telling him that there was an element of dishonesty involved in that opportunity. Now, as a boy of 9 to 10 years old, would he surrender to the temptation in before him, or he would resist the temptation? This is the question in front of us, my dear students. I'll be taking your leave here. I'll be explaining rest part of the chapter during the next video lecture. Thank you very much. Take a good care of yourself. My piece of advice to you is read the chapter again in between the lines. Underline the difficult expressions you have learned today. Note them in your notebooks. Make sentences. Explore further, because the treasure that you yourself can get out of a piece of literature cannot be communicated by any teacher. So I would advise you to read it at your own pace, enjoying the treasures, getting the understanding of it. I'm always available to sort out your queries. You can leave your queries at my WhatsApp number. Thank you very much. Take a good care of yourself.